Christian characteristics of fellowship. And here I want you to look as John the Beloved. John was, he's one of my favorite of the 12 because he stuck with Jesus. And when everybody else ran, when it seems, well, he's a hero, when everybody else, including myself, would have ran and hid, he didn't. And Peter, the loudmouth, like me, what did he do? Oh, well, you know, this ain't going to happen, this ain't going to happen. They'll never come get you, they'll never take you. And when the pressure got hot, who bolted? Peter. And who did Jesus look at when the rooster crowed the third time? He looked at him and saw him, Scripture tells us. But John was humble. John was meek. John was mild. John was the only disciple that did not die. He was exiled at the Isle of Patmos, the leper colony. And he loved him some Jesus. And for us to be more like him would be a notch on our belt. Here he says, behold, look at this. Pay attention, listen to what I'm trying to say here to you, he is saying. What manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us. I have heard it said by some teachers before that doesn't say anywhere in the Bible that God loves us. Well, what did I just read? Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us. Behold, look at this. What manner? Magnitude. Abundance. What kind of love the Father gave without strings attached, bestowed upon, applied to us, who? We, the redeemed, the saved, the born again, the body of Christ. All right? That we should be called sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. What did he just say? If you today, tonight, whatever time it is at your location, if you are born again, you are a son or daughter of the Most High King. Do you hear me? Amen. Who am I? I'm nobody. Nobody loves me. Oh, me, oh, my, down in the dumps. I say that because, hey, I do that. You hear me? And I know I'm not the only one either. That's why I say that with my hand raised. Guess what? My Father loves me. And he owns the cattle of 1,000 hills. And all the rest that you can get therein, and all the taters that'll grow, and all the money that can be mined out of it, the gold that can be mined out of it, he owns. He has adopted us in. I know who my mother and dad are. Not everybody knows that. Truth be known. Jimmy and Patty have adopted 2 children, and they're just as theirs as if they were born legally. They've got their last name, Davis. And they're theirs. They're heirs to everything that they own. They're heirs, just as legitimate as their birth children. So are we to the Heavenly Father. We are heirs to the throne. We're heirs to God. Okay, I say that, and you know, that's like, okay, that's a pretty rose right there. Go on and not pay attention to what a rose looks like. A Joseph coat is amazing to me, how it starts out and as it blooms, how it changes colors. And only God can do something along those lines or do something like that. And we don't take time to sit and wonder upon those things. Same thing with lilies Jesus uses in Scripture, that there's not a king with more splendor than a lily. And God put that together and made it the way that it is and colored it up the way that he did, because he's God and he can and he does. Same way with you and I. We're knitted differently. We are different. Thank God for that. I'm different than you and you're different than me. That's the soup. That's the ingredients to make it the soup of life. The flavor. Because some of us are the salt and some of us are the corn, some are the water, some are the pepper. We're that that gives it the flavor. And that's what makes us unique and us amazing, because we are fearfully and wonderfully made, the scripture tells us as well. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. It's not by happenstance. And you did not come from a monkey and his tail fall off either. So, you are created by God. And look at this, where he says that we should be called the sons of God. All right, now those people on TV and others that you may know will say, you're crazy, you ain't got good sense. You've probably heard that. I have. Why? Because they don't know who he is. They don't know who he is. But guess what? You do. If you're born again, you know who he is. And he wants to make himself known unto you. He wants us to grow in him. He wants us to be more like what he is now. He's no longer in the earth suit that he was in, that Jesus was in, conformed to his image. He is in his resurrected body that he will be in and that we will see him in. And we will be the same. How do we do that? By becoming saved, being one of his, called his own. The world doesn't understand that because they don't understand the Bible. The world doesn't understand that because they deny that it's the Word of God. Some will say, go as far as even saying that it's not the Word of God, but it contains the Word of God. It's just a bunch of men that wrote some stuff down, That's not the way it is. It's inspired from in the beginning to even so come Lord Jesus. If from the beginning to the end, it is the inspired Word of God and he has given it to us. Look what he says here. Look how he is addressing this next verse. Beloved, that is we that are the saved, the born again, the beloved in the body of Christ. Beloved, now, he says, now are we the sons of God. Did it say that one day we will be? He says, now, if you're saved, you are a son of God. Exactly. And I was reading, and I read it last night, and I read it the night before, and just scratched my head on it, because I've used this as an example, but the guy used it a little firmer than I usually say it. But he says that you can no more. And it was, I can't remember what the author's name was right now, but it didn't matter who the author's name was. He says, you can no more stop being a son or a child of God than you cannot be the son or the daughter of your birth parents if you are truly saved. And that's what the Bible teaches. That's what Scripture teaches. Does that mean we're not going to make a mess? Absolutely not. Does it? Because do children do? Did I make a mess? Do I make a mess? Whatever. And God does what? He'll break that belt out and he will not spare the rod, and because he don't want spoiled children. But he doesn't abuse them either. But at the same time, he straightens kids up, his children, which is us. And once we're born into the body, our name is stamped on the birth certificate, or his name is stamped on our birth certificate. Like when Ashton was born, our name is on her birth certificate. We are her parents. God is our Father. He says right now, behold, we are the sons of God. if you're saved, you are a son or daughter of God. And it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that we shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. We shall see him as he is. How is he right now? Stephen looked up and saw him, did he not? And recognized what he looked like. He will have whatever, you know, I saw this thing on 9 and I was watching, she was halfway watching it. It was a thing on, I can't even remember the name of the painting. Supposedly an angel gave it to some pope back in the day. And you can see through it or whatever, and it's a picture of Jesus of what he looked like. And, you know, come on. Yes?
Can I share some verses?
Please.
Go right along with this.
Please do.
Romans chapter 8, verse 14.
Mm-hmm.
For as many as are led by the Spirit of God,
mm-hmm.
they are the sons of God.
Mm-hmm.
For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear.
Right.
Ye have received the spirit of the God.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Father. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are
children. Mm-hmm. Read verse 29.
Verse 29.
Uh-huh. 8.
For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be
Uh-huh. That's it. That's it. So we are to be conformed to his image of what he is now. How is he? He did what? It says in Scripture that he was not left in the ground like David was. David stayed in the ground and his body saw corruption, meaning his body saw decay. Jesus was raised again before his body was able to see destruction or decay. He was raised again. He was saw among 5,000, then among 3, and then among all those. The road of Emmaus as he walked with him that day. And as he ascended in Jerusalem, only God himself knows how many saw him then. And he was carried on a conversation with them, talking with them. He appeared through walls. He made hoe cake and fish. He made these things, and we shall do the same. We will enjoy some of Granny's biscuit and some gravy, I do believe, you know, because Jesus made hoe cake and ate fish with them out there on the seashore. When Peter jumped off the boat and went to see him, as Jesus had a fire going, he made a fire and probably didn't even need matches to do it with either. And he made a fire and had some fish cooking and had some bread with them. You'll eat, we'll be able to see, smell, taste. We'll know him, we'll see him as he is, and we're to be conformed unto his image. We are conformed to his image. Yes, our body will see decay, but our soul, when we leave this body, will be present with the Lord. And then, when the rapture takes place, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, starting about verse 13, the dead in Christ shall rise first, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them, to meet the Lord in the air, okay? 1 Corinthians chapter 15, if he comes right now before we die, we shall be changed in a moment in the twinkling of an eye. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, this mortal must put on immortality. So there's got to be a change, and that's how we will be conformed to the way that he is right now. We are spiritually as he is. We are saved. Our soul is ignited, alive, born again by God living with the Holy Spirit of God living within us. But our bodies, we will take up that body as he did and raise as he did one day when the rapture takes place. So that's conformed to his image. Go ahead. No. No. Uh-huh. Business. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Absolutely. Look what... Yes, ma'am? Oh, okay. Look, he says, and every man that hath this hope... What does that make you think of, and what chapter and verse should that make you think of? The blessed hope. That's talked about in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. That is the rapture. This is the hope that we have. And he says in Ephesians as well, we are not as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus, and then he gives them the gospel, it tells them that we are not like those where we have hope because of what Jesus had, what he did for us. And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself even as he is pure. Who is your hope in? Is your hope in me? Is your hope in yourself? Is your hope in this church building? It's in the wrong place and it is misplaced. But if your hope is in Jesus Christ, it is firmly fitted and well-founded. If it's in Jesus Christ alone. See, and think about this for just a second. With salvation, Jesus paid it all. He did it all on the cross for us. All of it. So if we give him the credit for it, if we give credit where credit is due, what does that do? That makes God bigger and makes us smaller, does it not? That makes God more the owner of it and we're the beneficiary of it. That is the right perspective to have on salvation. I'm a beneficiary of it. I am adopted. I reap the benefits of something that I didn't do that he did for me. And I'm thankful for that. With that being said, what does that make me want to do? It makes me want to serve him more, want to worship him more, and be busy about his business more. Am I going to make a mess along the way? Yeah, I don't want to though. But you get to looking at things of the world or whatever the case may be, what I talked about in Ephesians. The devil can't stand it when you have that hope of salvation in your head and in your heart, that blessed breastplate of righteousness placed upon you, covering your heart. He can't stand it. He wants to take it away from you. So he starts sticking punji pits everywhere, starts putting debt wires up, IEDs, and everything he can to distract. He's good at it. He's good at it. He don't want you to hear this. He don't want you to know this. He wants to put a three-ring circus in the church and not even break the Bible out and have a flip-flop contest in here instead of what the Word of God has to say. And what does that do? Oh boy, we had church and didn't even break the Bible out. I'm guilty of saying that. What did you learn? What did you hear? You know what I'm talking about. Absolutely. And I can guarantee you it wasn't decent in order, as it says in Corinthians, let it be by three at most, and there will be an interpreter. It'll have been a whole bunch of them at one time, and more than not, it was the gender that shouldn't have been done to start with, according to Scripture. I'll hush before I say something I shouldn't be saying. Verse 3, even, and every man that hath this hope in him, look what it says, purifieth himself even as he is pure. So if you have your hope in Jesus, you're purifying yourself even as he is pure. Okay, the hope is not in you, the hope is not in the world, the hope is not in whatever, but our trust is in the Lord. But we're to help one another along the way. We're to bear one another's burdens. We're to pray for one another. We're to do all those sort of things. That's what we're to do. That is being busy about the Father's business. That is showing the love of God and using words if you have to, etc., etc., etc. All right. Okay, verse 4. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. Look what he says next. And you know that he was manifested to take away our sins. And in him is no sin. He became sin that knew no sin for us, as it said in Romans as well. But if you commit sin, you transgress against the law. Paul goes on teaching over in Romans, where he says that the law, he said he didn't know that there was sin until the law showed him that he was sin. Then when he found out that there was sin, he was convicted of his sin and wanted to make it right and wanted to get it fixed, and he did. And he found out it was through Jesus Christ the Lord instead of it being able to do it by works, lest he himself or any man should boast. It is by the grace of God that we're saved, not of works, lest any man should boast. Okay, and then as we read on here, he says, in him, it, look at this, not was no sin, but still is not any sin found, correct? In him is no sin. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Whosoever sinneth hath not seen him, neither know him. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. He that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. And see, that's how we can get in a pickle sometimes with understanding things, is mixing law and grace. Like, for instance, over in the New Testament, in Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, the Gospels, etc., Jesus was still what? Under the law then. He had not died and risen, and the Holy Spirit had not been given. Acts 2, chapter 4 is when the Holy Spirit was given unto us and starts abiding. When Jesus says, I'm going away, I paid the sin debt in full, and I will send you a comforter. He will no longer be with, and this is said, talked about in John, it was prophesying forth, that he will no longer be with you, but he will be with you, and he will be in you, a new thing that had taken place that had never been before in the history of mankind, when the Holy Spirit dwelt permanently within man upon the point of salvation. Okay, now let's read on here. Backing up for just a second. For this purpose, the Son of Man was meant. Look at this. For this purpose. For this purpose. The Son of God. You mean he had a purpose? Think about that for a second. Richard said earlier that we're to be busy about the Father's business. What did Jesus say that this is not my will, but the will of him who sent me? Remember that? That's talked about in John. John writes that. And what is his will? That all that God gives him will come to him, and he will save them. Okay? But Jesus, the Son of God, said, this is the will of him that sent me, that I am doing his will. Remember when he was saying the prayer, when he says, if there's any way, let this cup pass from me. That was the flesh side of him saying that, but the Spirit of God side part of it said, nevertheless, not my will, but thine will be done, knowing that there was no other way, and that before the foundations of the world began, that this was the plan of God, that it be done this way. So with that being said, for this purpose the Son of God was manifested. Look, that he might destroy the works of the devil. And he did destroy them on the cross, because the law couldn't do it, could it? Or didn't do it. We can't do it. He did it. Jesus did it for us on the cross of Calvary. Okay, verse 9 here. Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God. Let me read what he says here. Let me read Ryrie's commentary for you. And he says, cannot sin habitually. See the note on verse 8. Continual practice is the sin that we're all going to make a mess, okay? A continual practice of sin. Remember, I taught on this about 2 Sundays ago or 3 Sundays ago about what was the word that was used. The word that was used is immorality. You know, or it was, at any rate, it was a continual sin, habitual type of sin. Okay. He says, habitual actions indicate one's character. Seed, where there is a root, there will be fruit. Where there is no fruit, there will be no root. The divine nature given the one born of God, the nature prevents the Christian from habitually sinning. Think about this for just a second here. What happens? We have the Holy Spirit of God living within us, do we not? When we become saved. And He convicts. He beats us up. He encourages us. He's to come alongside or the one to convict us of our sin. What does John say? And I call it the Antichrist chapter in a way because it is Antichrist. It is against Christ. John 6:66, which says basically that they walked away from us because they were not one of us. Judas was not one of them, even though Jesus says, have I not chosen you 12, and one of you hath the devil? And he had deceived them, that so much so that when they were in the upper room to have the Last Supper, the Lord's Supper, that they didn't know who it was. Jesus says, one of you will betray me. And they said, Is it I? Didn't know who it was. He says, he that takes the sop that I give the sop to is the one. And did and handed it to Judas. He says, that you must do, go and do. Judas got up and here he went. And they went to the garden. And here comes Judas with the flip-flop boys. And gives him a kiss on the cheek. The kiss of betrayal. As they betrayed him unto the Romans. Peter tried to stop him. Okay, look at that. Think about that for a second. Now, I'm not chasing rabbits here, but I'm stating some facts. Man trying to stop the things that God has put in place to take place. It's futile. They came to get Jesus. Peter's showing himself, says, it won't happen on my watch. Watch. As he pulls his case bowie knife out, and he tries to cut Malchus's head off, but kind of misses and just takes his ear off. Jesus rebuked Peter for it. Reaches over and gets his ear and puts it back on him and heals him right on the spot. Hung him up. Peter tried to stop that from taking place. Jesus says this thing must be. Because that's what he came for. That's what his job was. That's what he came to do. Was to die for us so that we can have life and have it more abundantly and have life everlasting. Okay, verse 10, and then we'll shut her down, maybe. In this, the children of God are manifest in the children of the devil. Whosoever doth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. For this is the message that ye heard from the beginning, that ye should love one another. We'll just stop there, and we'll pick it up and take it from there next week. But think about that. You're known by the fruit that you bear. Where there is root, there will be fruit. Where there is no fruit, there will be no root. Questions or comments? Right. And interesting thing about it, here and playing words on that, we are so saved that it says in Romans that justified, then glorified. It's as if we're in the heavens right now. Our sin that separated us from God, that is the heaven or hell issue, has been dealt with. But the sins, plural, that we will be judged by, receive or lose reward by, that we commit. But the sin that separated us from God, that had us, that the original sin that we needed to be cured by, that nothing but the blood of Jesus can cure. The only the blood of Jesus can cure from the other sins as well, by the way, mind you. But we're still going to stumble and stump our toe and make a mess along the way. And what do we do, as we talked about in Corinthians this morning, as we talked about as well in the book of Revelation, whenever he tells the churches that they are to repent. When you make a mess, repent. Stop what you're doing. Ask for forgiveness for it and press on. And that way the relationship is restored. Repent from it. Repent, repent, stop, 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 repent. Turn unto Jesus. Because if you, well, it's another story altogether again, but very well spoken. Anybody else? John, as in Big John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John 6. Mm-hmm, 66. That's why I call it the Antichrist chapter.
The verse right before that, very interesting.
Yeah. Except it were given unto him by the Father. Right. That's John 6:66. And it says, from that time, okay, well, look, verse 64. For there were some of you that believed not, those that were with him. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were that believed not and who should betray him. Okay, verse 65. And they said, therefore said I unto you that no man can come to me except it were given unto the Father. That's why you look in the Gospels where it says, he that comes by any other way is the same as a thief and a liar. If you try to work your way to heaven, that's the same as a thief and as a liar. You won't get to heaven that way. It's only by the blood of Jesus going through the sheep gate there. Verse 66, from that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Then said Jesus unto the 12, will ye also go away? And look, here is the difference. Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life, and we believe and are sure that thou art that Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered them, have I not chosen you 12, and one of you is a devil? He knew, he knows, because he chose, he calls to be. There's a bunch in the church. And see, that's where you have to be careful with the eternal security thing, because it brings up a question. If someone is a continual whatever, does God live in them? See, we let God judge that. We're not the judge of it. Okay? But if there's repentance, stop, etc., etc., God has dealt with it. God has fixed it. If there is no fruit, that's why he tells us to be fruit inspectors. If you see fruit, there's a root. If there is no root, there is no fruit. It's an artificial plant. Questions or comments? Mm-hmm. Because you can, and that's why, you know, some would doubt one's belief system or who they are in God. Sure. Well, see, the demons, it says, know who he is, and they tremble. But see, there is no means of salvation for them either. They know him and tremble. They know that the devil knows these scriptures better than we do. Exactly. Absolutely. Absolutely. So he's beating us up, doing everything he can. That's why we're to put on the whole armor of God so we can stand against the methods of the devil in this evil day. Questions or comments? Either my hearing aids are going out or it's humming one or the other in here. Okay, because that's about... Yeah. I'm wanting to like start bark or something, aren't you? Yeah.